Podcast. My name is Jessica Lubianski, and I am so very excited today to be joined by the Archbishop of San Antonio, Archbishop Gustavo Garcia Sierra. So thank you for taking time out of your schedule today, Archbishop, so that we can dive in and talk to our young church about the saints.
Well, thank you for the invitation, Jessica, and it is a great opportunity to share a little bit about saints and what does it mean to be a saint. Saints are people who follow Jesus, and follow Jesus because of the call that they receive in baptism. But of course, when somebody is baptized, especially if it's a baby, that baby doesn't know what is the call to holiness. But eventually, if that baby learns with time what is the call to holiness that that individual received in baptism, the person responding to that call, inspired by the Holy Spirit, by God's grace, will be able to figure out what is it and how to go about. So there are all kinds of saints. That means that they became, with God's grace, sanctified, and they are holy people because they follow Jesus, sometimes invited by his words, sometimes invited by his actions. With words, for example, when Jesus said, "Blessed are the pure in spirit," maybe a person will say, "Why not be pure?" Or, "Where is your treasure is where you will find out that your heart is." You say, "My heart is in loving God, teaching, or loving God, helping the poor, the needy." You know, so those are words. When Jesus says, "Carry your cross and follow me," and some people are carrying heavy crosses in life. Could be an illness, could be that they are fighting injustice, that they are protecting babies in the womb, whatever that is. But in such a way, they become kind of beaming lights for others to see. In other cases, could be not the words of Jesus, but the works of Jesus. So sometimes Jesus, for example, he preached. So somebody feels a call to follow Jesus in preaching, and to do it with generosity, because faith, hope, and love. Well, that person evolving in that service and ministry, that person will become holy. It could be another example. For example, when Jesus died on the cross and he said, "Forgive them. Forgive them because they don't know what they are doing." And that person feels called to forgive and to invite people to forgive others. So that person becomes holy because of the Holy Spirit working in him or her. And as he imitates that action of Jesus and those words of Jesus when he was on the cross, could be, and this, the saints, could be people that they are in marriage, single life, in religious life, priesthood, and the episcopacy as bishops. The call for holiness for everyone. But when the church defines someone as holy, is a whole process that leads to that moment. And that means that there are witnesses of the edifying example of that person. And this is done after the person died, which means that the person in life following Jesus was responding to the call as a Catholic in the church to express virtues of Jesus and the example of Jesus in whatever vocation that person had. But the process for the church to say this person has qualities of a saint and to promote the cause is long. Not necessarily very, very long, but in some cases have been in few years, some cases have been taking decades, you know, to be proclaimed saints. And for that, the church has structure and how to collect information, to listen to witnesses, and then eventually there will be miracles that the faithful people ask through the intercession of that individual that is called to become a saint. And eventually those miracles take place. There will be a sign from the Lord that that person should be promoted to what we call the altars. That means to be signs of God's mercy above to the people of God, and that God wants through those individuals called saints to bring people to himself. And so there are two steps there. One step is the beatification. And the beatification usually responds to the immediate people that that person affected with his example and his works, even after, in life or after the individual died, that that they are known to that group. So it's more local. So the person is beatified. And then the last step is the canonization. And the canonization is when the church proclaims that individual a saint for the universal church. We have plenty of saints in the Catholic Church, and not all the saints have specific feast days in our liturgical calendar. That means that when we go to Mass, sometimes they say, "Is St. Patrick's Day?" Well, that has a place in the calendar, liturgical calendar. But all the saints have a date, but not necessarily that is a date that is known to the whole world. Could be locally, regional, depending on whether that person was known. If the person is from North America, or the person is from Africa, in a particular area in Africa or in India. No. So, and there are saints of all ages. So sometimes we think that saints are those who live a long life and they were really good all the years of their life that they live in our midst, in the world, that they were with us. Not necessarily. Not necessarily. There are saints that became saints, but at the beginning of their lives, the very first 30 years or whatever, they were very, very difficult years, and they were not very close to the Lord. But eventually, they converted, and they became examples of what is the Christian Catholic Church, an example for others. Some, they died very young, like St. Teresa of Lisieux. She died young, 23, 24 years old. Well, and she was in the convent. Then we have bishops. They became saints because of their leadership, in the local church or the universal church, like popes. You know, we have John Paul II, for example, we have Paul VI, John the 23rd, to say some of the recent popes. But it's after a period of time, you know. So that is pretty much what the process is in general. People then are so edified with their example of life that they ask them in their need to intercede, you know, to the Lord, and the Lord will grant that those favors will allow those miracles to take place in the lives of those individuals who pray through the saints. Also, one for me had been very important about the saints, that they give us hope, because their example of life, Christian life, will lead us to be better. But also, to see the saints is an invitation. When you know the life of that saint, that particular saint, if you know that life, invites you not just to do better in life, but to long for holiness. And to know that one day we want to share with the Lord, with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the Blessed Mother, and all the saints, to share in heaven, you know. So that is a little bit about the saints. And in all the saints, of course, the one who stands up is the Blessed Mother, because she being immaculate, and in the way she not only was taking care of Jesus, but as a follower of Jesus, and the witness that she has given in the life of the church when she lived here on earth, but also since she's in heaven, how much good work she has done to bring people to her Son, and to bring people together, you know. I mean, holiness is not just in relationship with the Lord. All the saints praying about their lives is the impact that they had in other people, you know. It's not just me thinking of God all 24 hours, just thinking of God. It's the relationship with the Lord, the source of all holiness, but in their relationship with one another. Some saints, they improve the lives of families, some they improve the lives of workers, some they improve the lives of sinners, people in prisons. Well, and you can go on and on, because each saint is a story that can reach out to many people, you know. Though all saints share the same glory of God, but each one brings something.
Pope Francis has a quote. He talks about how the saints, they weren't superhuman. They're not some kind of superheroes, but they were just people that loved God, and they knew how to share that joy. And so I think it's so important for us as the young church to simply share that love of God. And that's what we're called to. Each of us have the ability to become saints. Sometimes we often feel unworthy and like we can't, but I am capable, just like the Archbishop is capable, and so many people in our young church, you are capable of becoming saints. Now, Archbishop, I have to ask you one more question. Who, besides Mary, is your favorite saint?
Well, you know, there are many favorite saints. I have St. Augustine, I have St. Francis of Assisi, St. John of the Cross, St. Teresa of Avila, and also the founders of my community, because, as we were saying earlier, you appreciate what the Lord has done and is doing through a saint, knowing the saint. So someone that I have known over the years was a foundress of my community. And in her case, she was married. She had 9 children. She was widowed with most of her children. And then she started a few religious orders and groups of laity. And she gave a tremendous witness in the persecution of the Catholic Church in Mexico and involved in society at that time and with the politics and to be a sign of the presence of the Lord for many people then. And her name is Concepción Cabrera de Almeida, and the nickname is Conchita. And I have learned many things about her. And as you were saying earlier, it's not that she was extraordinary all the time. Eventually, because of the work of God, God's grace, she became extraordinary light for other people to see and to learn and to understand God and to get closer to God. But she was a mother, you know. And so she was taking care of educating her children in a very, how you say, challenging times, and also in poverty, really. But for example, in that poverty, something extraordinary is that she used to go to areas where the poor and homeless live, meaning on the streets, and feed, to nurse the babies of the poor, for example. So we'll say, oh, in the United States, that's not possible. It's against the law. Healthcare needs to intervene. She was doing that, feeding, nursing babies of women on the street. Now, how she was able to do that? The grace of God, her spiritual life, I mean, how serious she was in dedicating herself to the Lord. So, it's not that she was like that in everything she did. But then, there are signs in which you say, God is telling us something here, you know. So, I mean, just that one example. But she's one of my favorite saints, of course.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for your time today.
No, you're welcome.
And thank you for joining us for this episode of Veritas. I would encourage you, young church, as you go about your week, look at some saints that you are interested in, that you've heard about, and ask them to intercede for you on your behalf. There is a community of angels and saints in heaven and our Blessed Mother that just intercedes for us and shows their love for us always. So thank you again, and
you're
we
welcome.
Will see you next time on Veritas.
Y que